time and time again in the music and cultures that I've identified with, Simon Grigg was there from the first scorings of New Zealand punk rock through the dance music revolution to a certain record heard all around the world, which weirdly enough was playing in Starks when I came down the stairs before. Simon doesn't play guitar, I've never heard him sing. He's the manager, the club owner, the guy with the label. He works with the talent, and that's a role where for a long, long time New Zealand was lacking. He's currently working on a book about what really happened with How Bizarre, and he'll tell us about that and many other things. So please, welcome Simon Grigg. Simon, the Suburban Reptiles. Everyone wanted to be in a punk band, I remember it. Was there a point where you realised that your destiny wasn't to be in the band?
It was kind of way before punk started. I decided I wanted to be in the industry somehow. I was fascinated by the industry. As a kid, as a 13, 14-year-old growing up, I looked at what was happening overseas, looked at the managers and the record labels and people like Andrew Lou Goldham, and thought, yeah, it's kind of interesting doing that side of things. I had no innate musical talent, so I was sent off to study guitar at age 12 by my mother. The guitar teacher sent me home and refused to teach me anymore, so I knew at that stage, you know.
I didn't get past the recorder at school.
Yeah, well.
It was traumatising. Now, the Suburban Reptiles, like any good punk band should, caused an outrage. Was there any kind of Malcolm McLaren-esque thing in that? Did you plan
There was, but it wasn't intentional. Like, one of their very first gigs was playing at a Catholic school, Marsland College. And I got in the gig by going and seeing Ben Levin, who was the promoter, and saying they were a blues band. And Benny said, well, we've got the school ball happening out in Marsland College, do you want to do it? And I said, yeah, okay, fine. So we turned up and the Reptiles turned up and they were covered in all sorts of swastikas and the whole lot. And they got up there and went, I'm trying to throw fear into it. And it lasted half a song. the police arrived and the whole thing was called off. I demanded a cheque, a $250 fee it was, and went to bank the cheque on Monday morning. The cheque had been stopped, of course. So I rang up the 8 o'clock, which was one of the tabloid newspapers at the time, as a concerned parent. And complaining about this punk rock band which had destroyed my child's school ball. And I think that was one of the outcomes. We managed to get off the front page of either that week or the week after, all three Sunday papers in the same week.
Well, I mean, I sort of wonder whether this was sort of concocted. They claimed to sniff imported cleaning fluids and drink alcohol laced with, in quotation marks, speed.
That was a press release I wrote. Something about strangling seagulls down on the wharves as well, I think it was somewhere. But the press loved it because this thing was happening in the UK as well. The Sex Pistols were taking off. And they could see what the Sun and the Daily Mail and the Mirror and stuff were doing. And they wanted some of that as well, so they lapped it up.
What were they like as kids? Because New Zealand was a different country then.
The Reptiles were like as kids.
Yeah.
The Reptiles were from an arty background. All of the band were basically art students. And they were in it for style more than they were in it for necessarily music to start with. Like, we wanted to form a band. We didn't necessarily want to make music. We wanted to do the, you know, almost like a Roxy Music sort of thing. And we were going to form a jazz band, Jimmy and I, the saxophonist. And then David Blythe, who was my school friend, turned up and said, have you seen the Sex Pistols thing? So I thought, well, this sounds interesting. So I rushed around and said, no, jazz band's off, we're forming a punk band. And that's where the Suburban Reptiles came from.
And they had two songs on the soundtrack of Angel Mind, which was another transgressive piece of
and the,
culture.
And the premiere was in this building. Up on the top floor, the Suburban Reptiles are split in half. Phil Judd had got involved with the band and he'd fired half the band. I was no longer managing that stage and he'd fired two of the founders. So at the premiere, two Suburban Reptiles played, almost at the same time. There was one half on one side of the stairwell and the other half was over there. And they were going between each other. It was just chaotic. It was, yeah.
I get the impression it was a chaotic time, especially moving into the AK-79 time. It seemed to have a lot of vitality, but
a lot of
maybe
violence.
Slightly out of control, drugs.
Yeah, there was a lot of violence, a lot of really bad Mr. Asia fueled heroin, and a lot of people didn't survive. But there was always like a positivity. There was always a core of people who were there to create. You had this like periphery out there of people who were going bad, basically. And a few of very talented people were caught up in the uglier side of things. But
now, Matt, let's look at another photo, because you really like this one, I know.
That's the Features. They were a fantastic band. One of the most talented bunch of people I've ever worked with. Made two singles. There was an album released last year, finally, the stuff we recorded years ago. But that's a photograph that was taken by my flatmate, Jonathan, and I hadn't seen it until a couple of years ago. Of course, it's on One Tree Hill, and yeah, I think it's fabulous.
Why didn't they stay together and do what they should have done? Because as you said, they were really talented individuals.
The bands often didn't stay together. It was such a chaotic time that it lasted for a couple of singles. And Jeb went off to do Fetus Productions and, you know, went for Flying Gun after that. And I don't know, they were very fast times. Things happened. I look back at the timeline of some of these things and think, shit, that was like only 2 months. I mean, all these things, it seemed like years. And the Features came and went. And it was over. We recorded two singles and gone.
Yeah, I remember the same thing when the Toy Love album was re-released, and everyone realised that they'd only been a band for 18 months.
I know, and it seemed like forever.
Yeah.
But they settled out on the edge of the Windsor Castle. It seemed like they'd gone on for years. But there's probably only about 20 of them.
Yeah. Now, we moved on to...
That's a great shot.
That's a wonderful picture.
That's a Murray Kamek shot. Murray's out there somewhere. And Murray's one of the great rock and roll photographers and a person who's influenced a lot of us, you included, I think.
For sure.
That's the North Shore Netball Centre. It's a screen of memories. And there's a whole series of these. But I just think it's an incredible shot. The energy of that shot is amazing.
I can remember, because I was a kid at school, when the screaming memories suddenly appeared, and there was this real pop thrill about it.
Mm. Like the Naked and the Famous are now. It's the same thing. You know?
Right.
I look at them and think, that's the screaming memories.
Yeah, they both got kind of exciting titles too.
Yeah.
The Young Blood and See Me Go just sounded like it had to be a great record with
yeah.
that title.
I know. We recorded that, I think, 4 times. And the very first version, the demo version, was the best. We never got any better than that.
What made them tick?
Well, Murray Kamek, once again, who took the photograph, said about 3 or 4 months ago that what happened in 1980, 79, 80, was this influx of kids that came across from the North Shore. There was this post-punk sort of inspiration that happened. These kids on the shore and garages at Ross Mini College and various schools over there saw this thing happen, this explosion happening in the city, and decided to form bands. And the Memes were the one that came out of it as the pop leaders. Blams came out of it as well. But there was, I don't know, there was a creative urge happening. And it was just kids standing up and going, look, we're happy to be alive, and we can make music. That's what Murray said to me, that's right. You know?
And this was, again, all before everything changed in the early 80s. Before the economic reforms and everything, it was a different country.
It was quite a dark sort of time.
Mm.
Now, we're talking Springbok tour, sort of, or pre-Springbok tour. There was huge violence in some of the gigs. The country itself was very isolated. We didn't know what was happening overseas most of the time. The newspapers, the magazines turned out 3 or 4 months later. So we kind of did things in a vacuum, and what we did in New Zealand sounded a little bit different to things that were happening overseas. It was all a little bit twisted. It's one of the great things about great New Zealand music is we get it wrong. And when we get it wrong, it's often so right. You know what I mean?
And you, of course, had Propeller Records.
Yeah.
You'd never run a record label before, I take it?
No, it was like, oh, I've got this, I'm flatting with these guys and they're a great band and I want to make a record. And you kind of knew that sort of thing was happening overseas, but I didn't know how to do it, so I just said, I'm a record label. And you go and you start making records. And before that, there wasn't really a record industry as such. There were major labels and there were like the odd recording studio making records, but there wasn't really much happening. Within maybe 6 months or a year of Propeller Stone, there was this huge roar of independent labels. It was flying down. It came along a year or so later. Yeah, I think the landscape completely changed.
And See Me Go went to number one, didn't it?
Mm, yeah.
Tell me about how records got to number one in those days.
Well, kids bought them. You know, it was nothing to do with the airplay. We got zero airplay. See Me Go, We were down country. We were in Whanganui or somewhere like that. And Senegal had been to number one. And I was doing a tour around that area with the band. And we went to 1ZW, whatever it was down there, and they said, do you plan on recording to the band? And I said, well, I went number one last week. And no one in the station had heard the record, because no one used to play the records on the radio. But there was a genuine groundswell of support for people buying records.
And also, let's look at another photo. I love this photo.
Isn't that a great shot? I'm not sure who took that. It's the pneumatics.
Is that
such a great band.
Murray, is that yours?
I don't know. Murray's here somewhere. Murray.
But you also had a, back then, you had a live market as well.
Well, these
you
guys.
Could tour.
And more than that, you could stay in Auckland and play at a live market as well. A band like the Pneumatics could do 5 gigs in a weekend. They'd do, you know, Saturday or Friday evening at the Windsor Castle, then go and play at Main Street, then play a Saturday afternoon gig, then a Saturday evening gig, and then play at Main Street again.
Was that possible because there weren't so many distractions? There were fewer things to spend your money on?
It was also a very hip time to make music as well. We didn't have dance clubs as such. There were, of course, a few of them, but there wasn't that whole sort of spread between... It wasn't so niche-ified, I suppose, and kids wanted to go and see live bands.
What was your role? Then you were going on the tours as well?
Yeah. I managed the Screaming Memes. I didn't manage the Blams. They were kind of managed by Tim Barr, who's here tonight. And the Pneumatics were managed by Paul Rose, who was my business partner. And we did everything. We booked the tours, we drove the vans, we did all that sort of stuff.
Well, and all three bands touring together, which I remember, I was a kid in Christchurch, I remember that.
The Screaming Blamanic Roadshow.
Yeah, and we could get into the pub.
Yeah.
And that was all we needed, really.
And that was, we followed the Springbok tour around the country. And we had the two singles by two of the bands that were like the anthems of the anti-Springbok tour thing. The Pneumatics had Riot Squad, which wasn't written about the tour at all. It was written about an excess cafe in Wyndham Street. And Edel Street, sorry. And Blams had There Is No Depression in New Zealand, which were both turned into anthems. And I can remember sitting and standing at Carlow Park in the, Carlow Park, in Mount Eden.
Yeah, Eden Park.
Eden Park. Yeah, my rugby's not very good, I'm sorry. Never recovered from the Springbok tour. And there were, I don't know, thousands of people protesting. And they were all singing There Is No Depression in New Zealand. And this like buzz went through. Like,
wow.
It was amazing.
Didn't you get beaten up once as well?
I got beaten up with Lincoln. It was, as on that tour, Tim Mann and some young guy were arguing. Over this, Tim had a multiple racist tours badge on. They were arguing over it, and I went up and said, "Look, guys, don't be jerks, don't fight." And this 6'9" farmer's son turned around and walloped me and said, "Don't call me a jerk." I was lying on the floor, blood pissing out of my mouth, and things. And I staggered away, and I was standing by the mixing desk about half an hour later, and my lip had all swallowed up, and this guy was coming towards me. Oh God, here we go again. And he walked over and he gave me a bottle of beer and he said, "You took that like a real man."